Hi, my name is Srinidhi Rao. I'm an NIT alumnus from the 2003 batch. Currently, I'm the head of innovation for the math company, which is one of the fastest growing AI and ML startups in the world today. Now, let's look at these five species out here that you might be quite familiar with. So this is on the rightmost side, you see Homo sapiens, which is you and I. And then before that, you said in a Neanderthal man, which was the species probably just before Homo sapiens came into the picture and so on and so forth. Now, let's assume for a minute that these five species are kept in a constrained ecosystem, an ecosystem constrained of resources for food and water and everything else, right? And a sizable number of them, let's say 10,000, population of each of these species. Right? And give them enough time, let's say about 1,000 years. So which species do you think will survive and thrive in that resource-constrained ecosystem and eventually dictate how much resources each of the species is going to consume? Most obviously, it's going to be the Homo sapiens. Right? So we have seen that time and again, how Homo sapiens have come to dominate this world that we live out here, as well as now even the space. Right? Now let's take Homo sapiens out of the equation for a minute. Let's assume that these four species are again put in a constrained ecosystem and given enough time, say about 1,000 years. Which species is likely to dominate, thrive, of course, survive, dominate and thrive the ecosystem and dictate the rest of the species in terms of what they can do and how much resources they consume? Well, we don't know for sure, but most probably it's going to be the Neanderthal man, which was the species just before the Homo sapiens came into the picture. Now, the question is, why? Why would Homo sapien, first of all, dominate, right? The ecosystem that's out there when Homo sapien is around. And then just before that, if Homo sapien is taken out of the equation, why the Neanderthal man? The most obvious and the most common answer that we get for this question is that Homo sapien is the most evolved species out there. But what does it really mean? Well, Homo sapiens is the most evolved, but what it really means on the ground is that nature, which is creating all this, got a few more millions of years to experiment different things in terms of what is required for a species to survive and thrive in an ecosystem, right? And based on that, took off a few things like a fin and a tail and a wing and whatnot, took off a few things and added a few more things like a thinking capability and a talking capability and whatnot. And then, coded them all into the DNA. So it made a few things of the DNA dormant, and then a few more things of the DNA got added, right? Codified all that in the DNA and put that and then sent across, right? That's what it really means. So nature got few more millions of years to collect a lot of data, do a lot of experiments, collect more data from it, right? And then codify something called the DNA based on that. And human DNA, the Homo sapien DNA, happens to be the one that got the maximum chance in terms of maximum amount of time for data, for nature to experiment and collect the data. So more data has gone into analyzing, right? What's happening, what's required in this world to survive and thrive. And that is what makes Homo sapien the most dominant species out there in the world today. Right. So from that perspective, if you see, data has always been the oil. The analogy for oil basically is that, it's a resource which when gotten and processed well, right, in the right perspective and gotten the right insights and used, will actually make you powerful, right? Or so oil, for example, oil was there in the West Coast those days, and whoever got hold of that oil and processed it right, would become the richest man in the world, right? So that is the analogy for data also, right? And from that perspective, data has always been the oil, right? And nature has proved it time and again, and we know all this right from Charles Darwin's times, if not before. So then why there is so much excitement about data today? Well, let's look at what makes data so exciting today for us, while we have always known that data has always been the oil, right? Even before oil, was discovered. So first thing out there is the fact that today, ever since the advent of internet, right, and the advent of social media, we have got a lot of data out there coming from all the different sources. And not just, you know, people entering the data, but you and I doing different things. For example, I take a selfie with my friend, right? And then upload it, that becomes data, right? I'm doing this speech today and it gets recorded, that becomes data, right? So on and so forth. So data is coming from all different directions and in all forms, from text to voice to images to whatnot, right? And then getting stored, right, in millions and billions and trillions of bytes every single second, right? That's the first thing that's happening out there. But just that having data is not sufficient, right? You should be able to get the data, move that fast enough and store in a particular place, right? And today the hardware has gotten so cost effective and space effective that the small smartphone that you have in your hand is actually stores, you know, gigabytes of data that was unthinkable just a few years before, right? So we can store data very, very cost effectively and space effectively today. And that has revolutionized not only data collection, but also data storage. But not just that, okay, just storing data, what's the use of it, right? You should be able to process the data in a time-effective fashion so that it's useful and relevant for the purpose at hand. And today, Moosla has come out to be really, really truthful, right? And everybody knows that it has become very, very successful, due to which we have transistors that are working at the pace that they are working, and we can process all those, you know, trillions and trillions of gigabytes of data in matter of seconds and milliseconds, due to which we can actually get timely insights, you know, from this data. And not just that, we have algorithms, the mathematics, right, that can process this data in a fashion that is useful for us, right? We have all those algorithms today, right, from all the classification to regression to, you know, whatnot. So we'll talk about a lot more algorithms today, but, right, so we have those algorithms that can process this data in a fashion that is useful in the time that is relevant for us. And last but not the least, right, the last mile, the technology, the UX and UI technology has gotten to such a level that we can actually implement these insights on the ground in a timely fashion. For example, if Amazon knows that, okay, it has to recommend, say, business books to me and say tennis rackets to you guys, right? Now, okay, finding that out is great, but unless the technology enables you to deliver in such a way that I get a different set of recommendations and you get a different set of recommendations on the same website, right, it's useless, right? So UI and UX technology today has developed so much that personalization is actually possible. So all these things have come together, from data, storage, processing, math, and technology from a last mile perspective, have all come together to make analytics, right, an idea whose time has come. And for the purposes of this conversation, let's define analytics, right, as just defining, getting meaningful, meaningful insights out of the data that you have, right? Let's keep it very simple and very straightforward. So you can harness data in a timely fashion and get meaningful results out of it, right? And if you can do that, of course, you have more profit, get better results, more accurate results, and so on and so forth. And of course, what's AI, right? So AI can be called as a special field within analytics that is an endeavor of human beings to emulate nature and to emulate human being itself, so that, you know, you can make a machine talk as if a human being is talking and you should not be able to make out the difference. Or you can make a machine think like as if a human being is thinking and you should not be able to make out a difference. So that is a human endeavor of AI. So AI is just a concept that is trying to emulate, right, a human being and nature itself. And eventually, hopefully, surpassing it in terms of how the decisions are taken and so on and so forth. Great. So what does all of these things coming together, from data processing, storage, UI, UX, math, all of these things coming together and making analytics an idea whose time has come, what opportunity does it give us as a species and in the time that we live in today? Let's look at a few things. Of course, as we talked about, we can personalize the experience in the context of a marketing and customer experience, so that eventually everybody gets to see and hear what they want, right? So I need something out of a particular store or a particular website or a particular YouTube or whatever, right? I get what I want versus you get what you want, and the machine is intelligent enough to recommend what you want versus what I want. And what it does for the industry and for the business, obviously a lot more conversions happen and the industry makes a lot of money. Similarly, personalization from the perspective of being able to go from point A to point B in a very, very personalized manner. So Uber can today recommend a different price for you, a different price for me, to go from exactly the same point A to point B at exactly the same time. I can't just not Uber, just, you know, I'm talking about a technical capability here. and Netflix and any other website can of course recommend, right? So what might interest you versus what might interest me, so that there is a maximum chance of you and I converting, right, for that particular show and then continuing the subscription of Netflix. But it doesn't stop here, right? It's not just about, no, it's not just about recommending an action movie just because I watched an action movie in the past. But today you can go one step further because the math has developed so much. So let's assume that Netflix wants to recommend Stranger Things to you and Stranger Things to me. Not just that the Netflix knows that I might like Stranger Things, I might convert. But just by going a few steps further in an analysis, Netflix and any other company on its place can also know why I would like Stranger Things as against why you would like Stranger Things, right? What is the deeper attitude and deeper reason behind it, right? Is it, you know, maybe I like, you know, Stranger Things because there is, you know, I like child adventure for that matter, right? Or you might like Stranger Things because you like, say, horror, right? Whatever. Now, Netflix can go so deep into your persona and figure out why you might like versus why I might like, and like it can personalize the thumbnails it will show to you versus me, and you and I might see two different thumbnails for the same Stranger Things that is being recommended. And it's just an example. Netflix is just an example. It can happen anywhere else and any other website. So we have actually, like, you know, implemented it in many more e-commerce websites, right? But the idea is that we can dig in into the human's person as to why you are doing what you are doing. That can give very rich insights into the human persona that can be used to make your experience very, very rich. And next aspect is, technology has grown so much. You know, today, you know, hear about AR and VR, augmented reality and virtual reality. And I'll show you the video about, how Sephora has exploited, right, or used, exploited is not the right word, but used artificial intelligence, of course, and, you know, VR and AR to give that customized experience to this lady out here. Right. So if you go walk into a Macy's store or any other store, you can actually experience these beauty gadgets from Sephora without actually trying out on your skin. Now, virtually you can see, right? So you can change the skin. You know, for example, here you can see change the colors, right? And then see how the how the color of the eye changes if you apply any of this, right? It's a beautiful example of augmented reality, right? That Sephora has experimented and actually productionized it real time in many stores across the US, right? A very good example. So obviously it saves money, for the company. And also it gives the user such a good experience because she can try out so many different colors in a matter of minutes without actually getting her, skin dirty or whatever, right? And overall, it's a good experience for everybody and makes a lot of money. Now, these were all, examples of marketing and customer experience, but it's much beyond that. Let's look at a few more functions, right? Let's take manufacturing, for example. In manufacturing, right, so a lot of very interesting things are happening. The biggest ones being, we can predict if a machine is going to fail in your assembly line, right? So many minutes before it actually fails, or in many cases, many days before it actually fails, or a train engine failing, right? I mean, so it's a question of lot of people, or an aircraft engine or aircraft part failing, right? So we can predict all that much beforehand so that you can save lives. And predictive quality, which is basically after your manufacturing line, if a particular part is going to come that is defective, you can know it much beforehand so that you can actually avert it rather than doing it post facto and actually having a bad quality part. But the biggest thing that's happening out there in the manufacturing world as far as AI and ML is concerned is this beautiful thing called digital twins. So digital twins are basically digital replicas of machines. So if you want to change the settings of a machine from one batch to the other batch or one part to the other part, right? It takes a lot of time and effort to actually change it, right? And then do a lot of trial and error and eventually get the right settings, right? But you can do all that now digitally and figure out the right settings and then only go implement it in one shot on the manufacturing line. And of course, digital twins can do a lot more things than that. Digital twin is a very powerful concept. It's a digital replica of your manufacturing process and manufacturing machines. Store optimization gets very, very, very interesting, right? So, of course, a store, both physical and digital stores for that matter, right, have a limited shelf space. In that shelf space, what are all the parts that you can store? What are the SKUs that you can store? How many different items of a particular SKU can you store? What should be at eye level versus what should be above and what should be below to maximize your sales, right? And so on and on. What should be kept beside each other, right? And how do you make sure that you sell more of your private labels? You know, what should be the pricing? What should be the positioning? And so on and so forth. Store, entire assortment optimization, shelf space optimization gets very, very interesting, and it's a very interesting math if you want to read about it. of course, once things are there on the floor, on the shop floor, then the next thing that you do is to price it right, right? And pricing and promotion analytics has gone very, very, very far, where you can actually customize the price for you and I. And now, I guess you might know that there are many websites already out there that will give different prices for you and me, right? For the same itemize the price. And of course, the promotion, because while, you know, promotion is about pricing, but for example, it's a known fact right now that buy one, get one free is perceived as something different by the customer as compared to 50% off, right? Technically, it's the same thing for the company, but from the customer perspective, these are two different things. And you see that, you know, those boards out there on this slide, right? So hot offer, save this much, etc., right? So those things should be on a red background and yellow font, or should be in a yellow background and red font, right? And it has two different effects on the customer. We know that for a fact now, right? So what should be the optimized price and promotion, and what should be the most optimal way to convey that price or that promotion? And of course, I just give the example of FMCG and retail, but today analytics goes across the agriculture, pharma, healthcare, energy, of course, right? And insurance and banking and whatnot. So every single industry and function that you can think of today is using AI and ML to get the advantages that they would not have gotten otherwise, and give the kind of customer experience and risk management, you know, for themselves that was not possible just a few years before. So let's take a little bit about what are the challenges today, right? So if a computer or an organization knows a lot more about me than I know about myself, it can pose a lot of ethical challenges, right? And of course, there are privacy issues, as you already know, right? And a lot more challenges out there in the world today, and policy related issues, as you can see with the government of India and Twitter happening, right? And so on and so forth. And the biggest challenge I see out there as a techie is the limits that we are hitting of the Moore's law. Not the physical limits, it's still, we can go to chips that are made of a few nanometers, but really the economic limit of Moore's law, where it is getting costlier and costlier to do a smaller chip now. And I know that that's becoming the biggest concern for the entire computer supply chain today, and of course the mobile supply chain also. But the question is, can we overcome all these challenges as a community and as a society, right? And make better and bigger things out there, and make our own species a lot more powerful, and also sustainably make this world a lot more better place to live in, right? Or will we just use this technology just like any other technology? This has both sides to it, or no? Are we going to use this technology to just destroy ourselves and this world, right? And then have nothing to say when the world says that, okay, Homo sapien was the most powerful species out there in the world, right? So it's in our hands, right? With that, thanks a lot for listening, and all the best.